Okay, so today we'll discuss different specification, why it is important, what all different parameters which are there in industrial robot, so that you, when you think of buying an industrial robot or using an industrial robot, you should know this parameter, which makes you a good user at least, if not a designer, you know how to use a robot at least. That is what is the least which somebody expect when you join a company that has installation like this in their assembly line or somewhere, okay, and you join there as a mechanical, electrical or a computer engineer with a background in some bit, little bit of robotics. When you have committed, yes, you know robotics. So these are some things which are definitely should be there in your requisites, okay. So what is a payload? Payload is basically a term which is very, very important while selecting a robot. This defines the application directly, okay. So how much load this robot is going to pick up, okay. So how much load it can pick up, is that all? It can just pick up or it can move with some velocity? Yes, it is basically for everything. It can pick up that much of load, and if it has defined that this robot can move at say 2 meters per second, yes, it should be able to move with that load at 2 meters per second also. So, and even the trajectory, if they have specified this will follow that trajectory to this much of precision, it should follow that. So whatever parameters apart from payload also they have mentioned, all those parameters should be valid with this much of payload. Got it? So this is one of the very important thing. It is a maximum load that a robot can lift in all possible configuration. It can take this, and it can be closest to your body, it can be little farther away, it can be in any XYZ configuration. Again, it can be any position within the workspace, specified workspace of the robot, and parallelly it should be just a sec. Okay, so this is there, means in every configuration, maybe a position, maybe orientation, in all the possible configuration, this robot should be able to carry this much of weight. That is first. So this figure shown below basically shows different orientation position possible. There are infinite position orientation possible within the given workspace normally. Okay. And then it includes the weight of the end effector of the tool. Normally robot, when it comes with a flange. So if you can see this small toy which is there at my in my hand, this comes just with a flange. You see there is nothing attached to this. So robot normally comes like this. Even a humanoid, if you buy, a human can have just the arm which is having nothing. It can have a 2-fingered gripper, it can have a 3-fingered gripper. It normally has nothing in it. So it includes the weight of the that particular flange, okay, the tool which is attached, as well as the weight it is going to lift. So by default, robot manufacturers, they specify the payload without including the gripper weight. That you should remember. If at all you have bought a robot seeing that it is 5 kg payload, so it may not be sufficient if you buy a 5 kg payload with 4.5 kg of gripper itself. So it can effectively carry only that 500 grams of load that is remaining. Okay. Industrial robots are certified. All the certifications which they claim, ISO for repeatability test, for different velocity test, for trajectory following, different ISO certification which they give, like maximum velocity also, they consider this weight while evaluating those parameters also. Okay, so this is one of the very, very important when you want to apply this robot, and if at all robot is there, you should know what is the limitation of this particular robot. Okay, then very important thing is, apart from the load, you see what is there? This is a box which is fitted on one of the arm of the robot. Yesterday I showed it in much zoomed way. So this is basically loaded onto the third link of the robot. Third link of the robot, what it is basically, that itself is a payload that comes under a payload only. Okay, maybe the effect is little less, but yes, they have already specified in their data sheet this supplementary load maximum value. Okay, so this has been excluded while they have specified 5 kg for this. This was not there. This is an additional payload which it can carry on its one of its arm. This basically has all the valves. Maybe if it is a pneumatic gripper, it is supposed to have pneumatic valves inside. That is what it is there. It is an additional payload apart from the robot. The maximum dimensions also are mentioned because, you know, the moment of inertia of this also has influence on the dynamics, the way the robot behaves for a particular trajectory. So this particular load dimension is also there. Dimension influences a lot when you calculate moment of inertia of a particular link. You need not to calculate, but for you, the manufacturers, they specify what is the maximum size that you can carry, what is the maximum weight that you can carry over here in this particular section of the robot. Okay, then comes number of axes. This is one of the most important thing which a robot manufacturers mention. One of these which is shown here is a SCARA robot. It is a very popular configuration of a robot which has 4 degrees of freedom. And then the one which is here is very, very popular one again. It is a 6 degrees of freedom arm robot, standard serial industrial arm. Another one is a cobot architecture. This is an industrial robot manufactured by KUKA Iowa. Okay, it has 7 degrees of freedom robot. So you must be thinking, what is the difference? How does it matter if it is 4 DOF or a 6 DOF? Again, the maximum capability of orientation and positioning depends on number of axes. So you know, in a space, you can put an object in XYZ position and 3 different rotations. Those are possible. 3 different rotations which are possible, and that is known as orientation. That is known as orientation. So total 6 output is required. So it is quite clear, you need at least 6 inputs so as to control 6 independent outputs, right? So that is what is needed. So a 6 DOF robot should be able to do all the 6 translations, 3 translations and 3 rotations. Okay, but in case of SCARA, what happens? It is a 4 degrees of freedom robot. This architecture can show you directly that this end spindle cannot roll. It cannot roll, it cannot pitch, it can only rotate in its axis. So it can only rotate in its axis, and rest of the thing gets it to a place. That means X, Y, Z is possible. That means 3 position it can attain, that is X, Y, Z. It can locate anywhere in space, and it can orient in only your way. Okay, it can only rotate. So rotation, only one thing it can attain, whereas positioning, it can attain all the 3. So this is what is 4 input, 4 output system, that is SCARA, whereas this one is very much like this. It is very much like this. So you see, it has 1 degrees of freedom like this. Okay, another one is this, it is this, then comes this, this is 3, and maybe this one, maybe this one. Okay, and then you have another one, this and this. So it has total 6 degrees of freedom, and all, none of them are parallel axes. In its by default, it is not always parallel. Okay, so each of them are independent inputs. So you can have independent 6 different outputs. That means this end effector can position anywhere in space. It can position anywhere in space, and it can orient in any angle in space. That means all rotations are possible. So this is a 6 degrees of freedom robot. And what about this? This is a 7 degrees of freedom robot. So what happens? It can have same position and orientation with infinite number of solution. With infinite number of, it is very much like our own arm. Okay, we have three joints which are here. Ball socket joint has 3 degrees of freedom, that is our shoulder joint. Our elbow has one, wrist has got another 3 degrees of freedom. So you can do one rotation, two rotation, and this, three rotations. So three rotations are there. So three over here, and one over here, that means total 7 dots. So in order to give 6 output, it has redundant degrees of freedom. So it has infinite number of solutions. So this particular arm is very much like our own human arm, which can have infinite solutions for a given pose. Pose means position and orientation. So this is what is the number of axes. Okay. Then comes mounting flange. This is a standard flange which is there normally at the robot's end effector. So when it comes with a bare flange. So the dimension of this particular flange should be very, very standard. That means there are standards which are there, so that let us say you have purchased a gripper that also has got a standard flange. All these flanges are as per DIN ISO 9409 standard. Normally all standard media flanges, they are known as media flanges, they have a particular hole pattern. So all the holes which are there for screwing this to fit this on top of this particular robot arm is standard. Okay, so you can just get the one of the gripper, you can fit it over here. Both the flanges should match based on one particular standard, and it gets things done. Okay, even if it is a welding gun, that also should have this particular flange standard. If it is a spot welding, if it is anything, so this flange is a standard flange. And then comes, this supports interchangeability. Why this is required? You can change this particular gripper, you can put this gripper to another robot which is there. Interchangeability is there for various end effector tool attachments. You can have different types of attachments in a specific industrial robot. So this is what is very, very helpful. Then comes pose repeatability. This quantifies the difference which occur between a commanded and attained pose. You have commanded to go to a particular place, robot goes to somewhere else. It never goes to the same place. Okay, but yes, that fluctuation is as minimum as possible for a particular robot, and these fluctuations in attained pose are statically determined for a repeated sets of visits to a commanded pose. Robot is commanded n number of times, actually 30 if it is ISO standard. So it is 30, it is specified in that particular standard. We'll talk about that particular standard later on. So it specifies a special method to do it, temperature, ambient condition, industrial conditions which are there before you do this calculation. But yes, they specify maximum deviation which can occur from the commanded position. That is what is pose repeatability. Okay, and geometrically it is the radius of smallest sphere that encompasses all the position reached for the same commanded position. Okay, for the same commanded position, wherever the robot has gone, you create a sphere which includes all those positions. The radius of that is geometrically same as that of your pose repeatability. Pose over here, it is not just position, it also can be orientation. Orientation has got a similar meaning and definition as well. So ISO 9283, that refers to this particular standard. I'll show you today how does a typical data sheet look like, okay, and where is this specified and what is standard which comes next to it. Mind you, these things are not there in textbook. Okay, so this is why this course is very, very important and informative for you all. Okay, ISO 9283 refers to the standards that define repeatability and its measuring procedure also, how it should be measured. Okay, you cannot measure when you have purchased it, you cannot measure it. you will have to quantify each and everything, place each and everything in place, so that before you go for this particular test, okay? And you have to have an independent measuring thing which can measure externally this particular robot, maybe an external certifying agency who can certify this also, okay? For industrial robot, it typically varies from 0.05 mm to 0.1 mm. So, which is, yes, very, 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 very great for this industrial robot. Let us say if I have said the payload of this robot is around 20 kgs. So, carrying that 20 kgs and maybe overload which is coming on the third link, carrying all those weight, and let us say it has also said it can move at 2 meter per second. Yes, so as soon as it takes the object from one place to another, it can precisely stop at 0.05 mm if it is so, at that particular accuracy, okay? So, that is what is repeatability. So, immediately it will stop not more than this much of deviation from the commanded position. So, you see it is very, very good. That is why industrial robots are chosen, where industrial robots are to be there. You cannot have an XYZ own robot in that place, okay? So, it is measured with a specified payload and maximum velocity under standard operating conditions as prescribed by the manufacturer, as prescribed by the manufacturers in their documented data sheet, okay? Then comes, yes, mounting position. So, something that you have just gathered, this repeatability is also valid for all the mounting position if it is said so. If the data sheet says this robot can be mounted in this orientation, vertically standing, upside down, on the wall or somewhere in the inclined plane. So, for all those conditions, this repeatability definition should be valid. That means it can carry 5 kg payload if it is there and 2 meter per second that is mentioned. So, whatever is mentioned, it is valid for all these mounting positions, okay? Then what is working envelope? So, this can be of different type. This is the workspace where this end effector can reach, okay? Where this end effector can reach. So, you see, if I take it like this, if I take it like this, at the end it cannot go beyond some value, okay? So, that is why it cannot go beyond, it never covers the area which is here. It can never reach there, okay? So, if it is like this, okay? So, maximum again it can be very, very straight and it can follow. So, you now understand. Envelope is the place where a robot can reach at all particular pose. That means it can orient in any manner as long as it is within its defined workspace. It can orient and also again it can carry that particular payload which is defined. It can move at maximum velocity which is defined, and even repeatability definition is valid in this particular workspace. It may be very, very good. It can be better in locations at about center place. It may be poor over here, but definitely not poorer than the definition which is there in the data sheet. Got it? So, this is very, very important. So, this is for a standard industrial robot. And then ingress protection. Ingress protection rating is defined by NEMA IEC standard 60529. These are given by IP codes, ingress protection code. It refers to the level of protection offered by any electrical enclosure. Electrical enclosure. Mechanical things, definitely it can go wet, it doesn't matter much. But yes, if at all electrical things are there, you have to be very specific how good or bad it is, right? Against any solid and liquid. Why solid? Sometimes it is a spray gun. Robot can be mounted in a location like a coal mine. Okay, you have plenty of dust all around. So, all the bearings may not freeze just because of that dust getting into that bearings. Okay, and even if it is in a painting environment, that paint should not get into the bearings or not should get into the motors, or it should not cause any fire hazard if at all there are electrical enclosures, or it should not make that circuit to fail. Okay, so that is what is the meaning of that, why it is to be stressed, right? It is given by IP with two different numbers for solid and liquid against different level of protection. It can be nuclear protection also. So different level of ratings which are there, like for example IP65 would mean robot is totally protected against dust. That is what is 6, which is here, which signifies 6 is for dust, and protected against pressure jets of water. It is not depth inside water, but pressure jets of water from all direction. That is known as a limited ingress can happen. That is what is 5, that is meant over here. So 5, 6 and 5, that is what. So ingress protection level 65. Similarly, then other parameter which is there, that is sound level protection. That depends on application to application. That is what, let us say you want to make a ventilator. A ventilator should not have more than 40 decibels of noise nearby so that it can be fitted in the ICU. So it has its own requirement. A medical robot which is used for surgery has its own level of protection and sound maximum noise that it can make. Industrial, it typically varies from 60 to 80 decibels, so which is quite good enough for industrial robot. For domestic, it is 60 decibels, that is considered safe. For medical, less than 40 decibels. For industry, it is 60 to 80 decibels is quite good enough. There are apps nowadays, you can try downloading in your mobile phone and see what is the noise of our surrounding objects and wherever you are staying, wherever you are living every day. Okay, you can check the noise decibels of your surrounding. Okay, even some machinery if it is running, maybe a fan or TV or fridge, you can go nearby and switch on that app, it tells you how much decibels it is. Try doing that today, I'll ask you next. So working environment also is mentioned in the data sheet, that is humidity, how much could be the humidity, how much percent of relative humidity, temperature, what is the maximum temperature, normally for industry it is 80 degrees, right? If at all you seek to use a robot in North Pole, you need to have this temperature specially certified by the manufacturer, got it? Then footprint area, this is very, very important. I'll show you a demonstration how a robot is fitted by next week. This is the footprint. Okay, if this is the robot, this is the place where robot is put to the ground. Okay, this is where it is grounded to the ground. So this is the floor area which it occupies when it is grounded to the ground, mounted on the ground. So this is what is known as footprint. Very much like its name, footprint. It is normally specified as millimeter by millimeter area basically. Robot demands against the requirement. Okay, this is very, very important. Against different requirement, this footprint can be different, and it is normally specified as a rectangular area, sometimes as a circular diameterian area. Okay, like for this robot it is circular in space, but definitely not as an arbitrary space. That has got no meaning. Okay, overall weight of the robot means if it carries 5 kg payload, that is a payload. But what is the weight of total robot? Let us say I want to make my lab in the third floor of my building. Can it be mounted over there? If it itself is of 200 kgs, and that is not the all, while it moves, it has got dynamic loads also. That can be even more, but this is just static load, as if it is being weighed on a scale. So it just says this robot is of 200 kgs, but it never mentions the dynamic load that can also come. Okay. So be very careful while you mount something on a floor or maybe on upside down configuration. So this is very, very important. Proprietary specifications are also there. That means what type of controller it is, what type of control, does it have a fan inbuilt? that can additionally create noise. You have to be careful. Yes, robot while running, it creates 40 decibels. But what about the controller? Does it require to be mounted outside the medical spaces? Teach pendant is there. Is it detachable while it is running? Wrist is there. How many degrees of freedom does this wrist has? Or what is the maximum angle that it can turn? So those specifications are proprietary specification that is also certified in the data sheet. Got it? Additionally, attachments like gripper, by default, robot comes bare. It generally do not have any gripper until unless it is very, very specific robot which is made properly for academics or for maybe special purpose medical robots. That gripper is mounted since the beginning only. But if it is not there, this gripper, if you attach it, it can be from different ATI make, maybe Shunk make, different companies, they make grippers, SMC they make, also Fisto make. So they have their own specification. So while you use any such robot, let us say this has got IP65 rating for ingress protection, this should also certify that particular standard, otherwise everything is gone. Okay, you cannot have a IP56 rating gripper on a 65 rated robot and for a particular application. Okay, so be very careful when you attach any additional thing on top of these robots. Check their data sheet. It should also cover all your demands of ingress protection and rest everything. Okay, so I'll show you some data sheet now. Okay, there are few other important aspects which are also there. Data sheet also mentions the maximum angle a particular joint can rotate. Although it is not very important, if you know the workspace, if you know your workspace, and definitely you know your robot can reach wherever you want it to go, this may not have that much of meaning. Yes, this is still specified in the data sheet for programmers. I'll tell you, while I teach kinematics, it has got some influence to avoid your robot to get into singularity. Okay, so in that cases, you cannot just program the robot in Cartesian workspace. You can program your robot in joint workspace also, so as to avoid singularity issues. Okay. So that is why for programmers, this knowledge is very, very, very helpful. Okay. And as an academician, definitely it is helpful. They go in and out, they go for design, they go for specific applications. That is why it is very, very helpful. It is there in the data sheet, but quite a lot of time it is not explained why it is given, why this is important. If I know, yes, my robot can go to this much of space, why should I know what individual joint can rotate? Right. Have you ever calculated how much your head can turn? It is different for different people. Yes, it is almost 180 degree for maybe few of you. Okay, but you don't bother, yes? So you should not be bothered for this until unless you do some specific programming. Okay, but it is there. So it defines the positive direction of rotation, useful in programming. It is useful in identify safe zone from link collision. To avoid, let us say you have robot which has some roof on top of this, you can definitely take care by limiting this joint angle through software limits. So that is also useful in taking care of any link collision. So you got some insight. These are very, very helpful things which is not academically taught in different robotics courses to say. Okay, so this is very, very practical thing you should know. Now I'll talk about classification. Yes, after this, before this, I'll try to get into some specific thing which is known as a technical data sheet. Okay, I'll just okay. So moving ahead, so what you can see here is a data sheet of a standard industrial robot that is known as KUKA KR23. So I'll tell you what it is exactly in more detail now. KR20 is basically, this is a KUKA revolute jointed series, that is 20 kg payload capacity robot. I'll zoom a bit. I hope you all can see. Okay, so with a C variant, that is a manufacturer specification, these are some assembly specifications which are given. So I'll get into little more detail now. So what all things which are there here? Technical data are there, product description is there, purpose is given, target group, what they intend to use, industrial robot documentation, maybe some safeties they have mentioned. Technical data starts right from here. I'll go here, let us see, because now that we know what is technical specification, we'll discuss more about this. So it clearly says it has 6 degrees of freedom. It has 6 degrees of freedom which are controlled by 6 axes. So these are known as axes. That means this axis, this vertical axis, different joints basically. Those are axes. Volume of the working envelope, it is in meter cube they have given. With this, you don't get much of an idea how exactly it will look like. You have to get into more detail. That also is given in the data sheet. Pose repeatability, you see ISO standard which corresponds to this is mentioned. ISO 9283, that is for repeatability, is given as plus minus 0.05 mm. That means if you command a robot to go to a place, it can deviate to a maximum of 0.05 millimeters. Right? That means maximum radius of all the points where it can go, that radius of that sphere should not be more than 0.05 mm. Weight of the robot is approximately 254 kgs. Rated payload is 20, as I have told, 20. So it is 20 kgs. Nomenclature that depends on manufacturer to manufacturer. It may have some arbitrary meaning that they only properly know that. But over here it is quite obvious. KUKA goes like this. I'll show you other data sheets also. So 1611 is the maximum reach. Maximum reach means if you stretch your arm fully, so this is the maximum position where your robot can go. Okay, protection rating, it says IP65, sound level less than 75, so it is industrially accepted. You cannot mount this robot inverted, inclined, or on the wall. It is meant to be mounted on the floor only. With a maximum footprint, not more than this, which is 575 by 5, 35 millimeter square. Permissible inclination is given. Permissible. So it has to be mounted on the floor, which is not inclined more than 5 degrees. So 5 degrees is acceptable for this. Default color is also very interesting. It has to be given. Background of the workspace should not match with the robot foreground. Most of the time, they should have a clear contrast. Okay, so you choose to have in industry. This is by default, robot should be very clearly visible because that is a moving machine. It is not a static machine. So not just that, every Fanuc has yellow colored robot. See, Yashkawa has some blue colored arm. Okay, maybe Fanuc has got yellow one, KUKA has got orange. So you see, it is very well contrasted color which is there. Controller is KRC4. That is proprietary specification. It has got its own meaning. We need not to bother over there because in industry you have enough of space, so normally it should be okay. That also has its own footprint. That also will occupy some space. So that is why it also has its own weight. Sometimes it is more than the weight of the robot itself. Okay, it can be as much as 1000 kgs sometimes. Why? Because any accident, anything falling on top of this, they certified that also. You can have something falling on top of it also. It is not like a desktop PC. Okay, so that is why it is important. So humidity class is given, not humidity exactly it is given. During operation, the maximum temperature which this robot can go, not this robot can work with, 5 degrees to 55 degrees of its own temperature. Okay, and minus 40 degrees to 60 degrees it is during storage and transportation you should maintain. Storage and transportation, not while working. Okay. Moving ahead, there are many other specifications. These are proprietary specifications. Going to access data now, as I have told, these are important because you want to protect your robot from singularity. These are helpful for programming and for collision avoidance. So these are maximum joint angles where your robot can go. So this is the maximum joint angle. So this is also there. This is the figure that I have taken just now. I have shown you. Okay, so this is the workspace which is there. This is the workspace. So volume of this workspace, 3D volume in meter cube they have given. That is very, very complex to understand. So better understand where exactly your robot can go and perform best. You should not choose your robot. Let us say if it is 1611 mm maximum it can go. You should not think of working all the time in this region. You should try to work all the time in this region. Just like our arm, you don't lift things like this with your arm fully stressed. You are most convenient to handle things like center space. So, same applies to the robot also. We'll discuss this in more detail while we'll discuss kinematics. Why is it so mathematical? Got it? So, this is all about, see, this is the maximum reach, 1611 mm. Got it? So, this is what was given in the technical specification. So, from center line of the robot, where it is fitted, to the maximum stretch distance of the wrist, not the end effector. So, that is what is mentioned as 1611. So, this is the best one where it can go with all possible orientation. That is why it is wrist center, not the end effector. Reach defines the position where it can go with all the possible configurations. That means it can be like this, it can be like this, it can be like this. So, this is the maximum distance. Got it? The physical meaning, now you have understood. Okay, now let me open one more data sheet, maybe of some other company. Let us pick up ABB IRB robot. This is product specification for ABB IRB 6700. This is ABB IRB robot. So let me see what all things which are there. Okay, this also has got many things. You see, structure is given, standards are given, installation procedures, calibration technique, loading diagrams, wrist maintenance, robot motion. Oh, it doesn't have the technical data, it seems. Let me see how it actually shows the robot mounted. Okay, some access data I could see. ABB IRB handling capacity is given. Different models has got different handling capacity. Okay. Maximum reach is given, 670. So, what exactly 670? It is not visible here.
So, what is the difference between handling capacity and for
this one? Maybe this is with the gripper, they are saying. This is with the gripper, lean ID, maybe with the gripper. If lean ID is selected, payload will decrease as stated above. It is given in the loading diagram. So let us see what exactly is the loading diagram. What happens? Your gripper has its own center of gravity location. I'll show you this figure exactly. Okay, so I'll show you this figure exactly now. See, what happens? Let us say if this is your gripper. Okay, it has its own finger. So what happens? This is its own center of gravity, its own center of gravity line. So it depends on type of different gripper, the effective payload location changes. So with lean ID means probably it is exactly at the flange, they can take more load, but when it is fitted with a gripper, its center of gravity is shifted little off and it can carry less payload. So lean ID, maybe it is exactly at the flange, you can load it with 5 kg, but definitely not when you have some attachment. So CG shifts little way off. Let us say this is a robot, you have a stress test pull. So torque which is going to come at this motor is little more if it is elongated a bit, right? So if it is 5 kg payload over here, it is little less at little farther distance, okay? So I hope this is this only. Maybe I can take up one more data sheet which shows more clear specification, okay? So let me open one more now. Okay. So I think this is a Fanuc series. Fanuc robot. See, all these data sheets are available online. You can directly download from the respective manufacturers. Fanuc, KUKA, ABB, all standard manufacturers. Got it. So let me see what all details which are given. I wanted to show you all the data which is by default mentioned. Which is by default, which is there. So quickly you can see it is very much like KUKA robot also. So axis is 6, payload capacity 50. For different models, it is little different. Maximum reach, repeatability. This also they have not mentioned the ISO standard, but if they are mentioning it is a standard company, it should be ISO 9286 only. Okay, interference radius. This is the additional parameter, which is maybe specific for this particular robot, not very much of use as of now. If it is of importance, I would have let you know. Joint angle range and joint speed in degrees per second it is given. Wrist moments is also given. These are wrist inertia is also given. So much more data is given. Humidity, it is straight away says not the standard 2.2K or something like that, it directly says 75% of humidity or less, short term, within a month, 95% with no condensation, with if condensation is not happening, 95% is also okay. You go by this, if at all there is no condensation which is happening, so it is happy with this also. Vibration, this additionally it is mentioning. So 0.5 g of vibration it can take up. IP rating 54, 67 is optional for this. So just Google out what is IP rating. This is not a class of, it is beyond the scope of this particular class. So I am not getting much into this. I have just defined it. I'll talk about this in very much in detail later sometime. Okay. So this also shows a similar work envelope. Maximum reach is visible, you see. So this is, you see, all the robot manufacturers, they have given you the data which I have just taught you. This will help you select any robot. Even if you are an academician, you want to buy a robot for your application, very specific, maybe a research application, you should know and understand what does it mean, okay? You should know and understand very clearly what, how this should have been mentioned. What is the maximum velocity? What is the limitation of my robot? Okay, I think that should all be for today. That's all from my side technically. Thank you. Thank you a lot. Thanks a lot.